Welcome to the next session of the electromagnetism module. In this seventh session, we will be discussing the sources of magnetic fields, the electromagnetic induction, and Faraday's law, and also with the electromagnetic induction, Ampere's law, and we will also be discussing Lenz's law. So essentially, two more Maxwell laws will be coming into the picture in this session. So first, starting with the magnetic field, we will be discussing the Biot-Savart law, in which we can ask the question, what magnetic field is set up when the current is flowing? So all this is coming from experimental results. Biot and Savart arrived to this expression that if you look at a little magnetic field, dB, at a given point, which we will call B, and so this all is associated with the length element dS of the wire, which carries I steady current, then this magnetic field will be perpendicular to the direction of the wire dS. It is going to be perpendicular to the unit vector, which we call R, which is directed from the dS towards the point where we are looking at the magnetic field, point P. It will be inversely proportional to the distance squared, where on distance I mean the distance between the dS and the P point, and it will be proportional to the current I. So we can put all this together, and that's what we call today as the Biot-Savart law. So in here we have the infinitesimal magnetic field to be some constant I dS vector cross product with the unit vector r divided with the distance squared. And of course, if we are interested in the magnetic field, we will have to do an integral. And here the constants are called the permeability of the free space, and it has the value of this 4 pi times 10 to the power of minus 7 Tesla meter per ampere. So if we are interested in the V, we will do an integral of the infinitesimal, and so this is the way how we can get a magnetic field at a given point. And again, we still have the permeability of the free space, the mu zero. So when we are solving problems with the Biot-Savart law, of course you should do a drawing first, and then you have to evaluate the cross product between the dr, ds and the r unit vector, and then you put all this thing into the Biot-Savart equation. And of course it's nice to have a parametrization of the system using variables that suit the problem the most, and then carry out the integration, and you should make sure that your results make sense. So just an example here, let's consider to have a wire which has now finite length, which we call and the current in here we call I, and so we are looking at this along the x-axis, as we can see it on the right picture here, and we are interested in the magnetic field, the direction of this magnetic field at the point B here due to this current. So when we do the cross product, we have the dS cross dr, so we know that this is going to be a vector. So we could take care of this as taking out, by taking the magnitude of the vector dS cross r, and then have the k here, which is really just showing the direction and its unit vector. So when we evaluate the magnitudes of cross products, what we really do is that it's going to be the absolute value of these vectors multiplied with the sine of the angle between the two of them. So r for the unit vector, the absolute value of the unit vector is 1, and the ds vector's absolute value is going to be dx, right? This was the ds, so if this is x direction, it is going to be dx. So what is the angle between this unit vector r and the ds here? Well, if we have a theta angle here, this is going to be a perpendicular spot, so that has the angle of pi over 2, so then this angle is going to be pi over 2 minus this theta angle. And then we keep the k to be the vector, which again is a unit vector and just shows us the direction. So the ds cross r is going to be the dx, and then the vector k, And then we realize that the sine pi over 2 minus theta is exactly the same as cosine theta. So now, putting this all back to the Biot-Savart equation, we find that the infinitesimal magnetic field is the same, is a vector product, so or it's a vector quantity. So we denote that vector quantity with the k vector, and then we have the b as the infinitesimal magnetic field's magnitude. So here again, we put what we just learned into the equation, and so now we can look at some geometrical considerations that the r, which is the distance here from the point to the p point where we are looking at the magnetic field, it can be calculated as a over cosine theta. So that is, you know, really just the trigonometric load at r times cosine theta. So r times cosine theta is the same as the a. By dividing with the cosine theta, we find this thing. And then again, with the x, again from the trigonometric considerations, we can realize that this is the same as the minus a times the tangent of this theta angle. So we are looking at the dx that we get by differentiating the x by the theta, right? So if I divide with this d theta, dx d theta is going to be the derivative of this. I have a constant, but two constants, minus 1 and a, which we don't care about. They are just going to be here. And then the tangent theta is what we can derive, and the derivative of the tangent theta is 1 over cosine squared theta. So this is then going to be our expression for the dx, which now we can put back to the Biot-Savart log. So now we have, we had 1 over r squared here. So that is, if this is r, then 1 over r squared is expressed as a minus 2 power. And we just really put in this for the dx here. So that means that this cosine theta the minus second power is canceling the cosine squared here. The a's almost cancel. There is going to be a division by a. We have this constant here, and then essentially we just have a cosine theta, and we still have the d theta here. So we are not interested in the infinitesimal, but the full one. So we need to do an integral, and then we do this integral by the theta. And so if we have an infinitely long wire, that we can get by moving these angles to be infinity, you know, like to move up until the length of the cable is infinity. So that happens, then we have the beginning angle to be, you know, 90 degrees, so that's pi over 2, and it we go from the minus 90 degrees to the plus 90 degrees, so and one of them goes with the minus sign. So the integral of a cosine is a sine, and then we input these variables, and so the sine over the sine, the pi over 2 evaluated the sine will give us 1, and then the minus pi over 2 gives us a minus 1, so minus 1 is going to be a plus 1, so 1 plus 1 is 2. So all this integration essentially just led us to the factor of 2, and so that's what we need to include. There is an extra minus sign, 2. And so we get that the magnetic field at this point B is the mu zero times the I divided by 2 pi A. That's the result to this question. So let's look at the magnetic force between two parallel conductors. So there is going to be a force acting between these two wires, which is proportional to the magnetic field created by the other wire, the current in which in the wire that we're looking at, and the length of this wire. So previously we just calculated that the magnetic field created by a single wire is this mu 0 times I divided by 2 pi a, which now we can plug in. So the force acting on the first first buyer is going to be the magnetic field of the second buyer times the electric current of the first buyer and then the length. So putting this in, we get mu 0 times I2 with 2 pi A, and then we multiply with I1 and the L. So it makes sense to look at the force per unit length. So we can divide with the L and just get that this force is going to be mu 0 times the 2 currents divided by 2 pi A. So this is actually the reason how we define the ampere. So the ampere is coming from the fact that when you have the magnitude of the force per unit length between two long parallel wires which carry identical current, and they're separated with 1 meter, then current is going to be is 10 to the minus 7 newton meter. If this is the situation, then the current is going to be 1 ampere. If the force acting on this, then it's going to be 10 to the power of minus 7 newton per meter. Ampere's law is now connected to the fact again that a current creates a magnetic field, and so this has no beginning or no end. It forms a closed loop, and that's a major difference between magnetic field lines and electric field lines. So we could look at the path integral over this the circular path of the current. So let's just say that we do see that the magnetic field in that radius is the same, so we don't really care about where we are, and so we can get factor out the b, and so we can just do the line integral of a line element in a circle, which after carrying out will give us the length of the circle. And we also know, which is calculated, the magnetic field is mu 0 I divided by 2 pi r, and then the length of this path on the circle is going to be 2 pi r. So we get that the line integral, the circular line integral, the closed line integral of the magnetic field is leading us to mu 0 times the current. So Ampere's law is saying that the line integral of this magnetic field around any closed path will equal to mu 0 I, where the I is the current in the wire. So if you are looking at problem solving strategy, and you make a drawing, you need to evaluate this integral, and you should check your answers. So one example that we could look at, just like really touching on it, not really solving it, is that when you have this wire, which has a radius of R, and it carries a current I, then you are interested in the magnetic field calculated from R distance, and then you can look at the R to be smaller than the radius of the wire or higher than the radius of the wire. It's very similar when you are outside, and on the inside, you are just interested in the charges inside of the wire, so you will need to look at the charge density and not the charge density, the current density, and then use that information. Magnetism in matter, we have three categories. One of them is ferromagnetism, and so that's the situation when the magnetic moments are aligned, they create a magnetized material even if you remove the external magnetic field. Paramagnetism is the situation when the atomic moments line up when there is a field, but after you remove the external magnetic field, the spins will randomize. And then diamagnetism is the interesting situation when there is an induced magnetic field, usually a very weak one, which is in the opposite direction of the external field. So that leads to some fun situation. Water is like that. and we can look at some videos about how you can levitate frogs based on this idea. Then the last Maxwell law that we are discussing is the Faraday's law of induction. So far in this course, we have been only looking at magnetic and electric fields whenever the time didn't change. So we had stationary charges and magnetic fields. So the next step to go is that we let these things go are in time. For example, if you have a magnet and then you move that in a wire, and what you experience is that some EMF is induced. So whenever the flux changes through the loop, then there is some EMF. And this EMF is proportional to the time rate of the change of the magnetic flux. So how do we express time rates? That is a time derivative. So the EMF epsilon is the same as the derivative of the flux, the magnetic flux dt. So if you have a coil which then contains n loops, then that means that this EMF is induced in every loop. So there is a multiplication of an n because these EMFs can be added. So when you have this problem where you have a loop of wires and then area of A, and then you have a magnetic field B which varies in time as a decaying exponential, so if B is like expressed as B max times E minus AT, and so when you are in the beginning, then you have maximum field, and the time goes by, you decrease the field, and interested in what is the induced EMF. So this is very simple. You really need to just do a derivative of this function, and even it's easier because the derivative of an exponential function is just an exponential function. So here the only difference is that there are these extra constants, so the minus e will come down from the body of the exponential. Lenz's law is simple but important, and it says that the induced current in this loop is in the direction that creates the magnetic field that opposes the change in the magnetic flux. So mathematically, this is expressed as a minus sign. So Lenz's law is really just a minus sign, but it is very important. So Faraday's law is that when you have a change in magnetic flux, EMF is induced, and this induction of the current implies the presence of some electric fields. And these must be tangent to the loop. So we create a magnetic field, it changes the charges, and then that means a presence of an electric field. The work done by the electric field in when you have a charge Q around the loop is going to be the same as the as the line integral of the force. So the force is expressed as the Q times E, and the line integral is going to give us a 2 pi r. So from this we can express the E to be the same as the electric field to be the same as the EMF divided by 2 pi r. And we also know that the EMF was calculated to be the time derivative of the flux, and the minus sign with Lenz's law. And we also know that we calculate the flux to be the same as the surface integral of the magnetic field. In case that's a simple situation, then this is really just the B times the magnetic field times the area A. And if we speak about, as we do right now, about a circle, that's going to be the area of a circle, which is pi times r squared. So if we have a time variation of the magnetic field, then the induced electric field can be calculated as the minus 1 over 2 pi r, the derivative of the flux by time. And so putting all this together, we find that this electric field is now then the minus r over 2 times the derivative of the magnetic field B, after all. So the Faraday law of induction can be written in the general form that the line integral of the electric field is going to be the same as the time derivative of the magnetic flux and the minus sign. So when you have a solenoid, for example, which has radius of R and there are n turns in that, and then you have a current I, which is changing in time as a cosine function, and you're interested in the magnitude of the induced electric field, then this is the equation that you use. That we have the derivative of the flux, and the flux is to be calculated as the magnetic field times the area of the circle, and the circle, the solenoid, has now a radius of R. So then the radius and the y don't change over the time, so we can factor them out. So the flux is really the minus pi r squared times the magnetic field's derivative. And the magnetic field was given, we can from the Ampere law get that is the mu zero times n times the current, and the current was now defined to be this I max times the cosine omega t. So we can take the derivative of that. And so I'm just writing this out here, and we know from the Faraday law is that the line integral of the electric field is just e times the 2 pi r. So taking the derivative of the cosine will lead to a sine function, and whatever was inside of the function is just factored out. So we can now put this all together and get that the answer to this question is that the electric field in the solenoid is r squared times mu zero times n times the current, and the maximum current I max, Im, times the frequency omega times the sine of the frequency and the time divided with 2r. And this leads to the end of this session. Please give your comments in the comment section.